And so I'll show you a few more clinical examples, and then we'll have time to talk. But one of the things that I find very helpful with patients, after I've shown how hypnotizable they are, I say, what this shows you is that most of the way we use the brain-body connection is the wrong way. So you get anxious, your body tenses up, you start to sweat. You notice that, you feel more anxious, then your body says, now he's really getting anxious. And it's like a snowball rolling downhill. You just build up anxiety in a kind of mind-body bouncing back and forth way. With hypnosis, you show that you can change the way your left hand feels. It felt different from the right. You can do it in a positive or a neutral, not necessarily negative way. And this is a way of teaching you to control and utilize the mind-body relationship. So instead of getting all tense, you can focus on something that may bother you, but get your body floating. Imagine you're floating in a bath, a lake, a hot tub, or just floating in space, or you can just be somewhere else. You know, if you're going through something unpleasant, your body is here, you go somewhere you'd rather be, or you can change your perception, make that part of your body feel warmer or cooler or tingling or numb, or just focus on sensations in another part of your body, and those techniques really work. And I'll show you a few examples of mind-body control before we stop for questions. One of the biggest problems in psychosomatic medicine is that we assume that it's a terrible thing to tell people it's all in your head, because all that means is that they're humiliated if they get better. I never tell patients that. Say it's a matter of how you manage the interaction between your mind and your body. This is a man who was sent to me just to help him get through the implantation of electrodes to control his intractable Parkinson's disease. He was a young man with, we think, chemically induced Parkinson's toxic exposure. And he stopped his neurosurgical procedure after 2 hours. He said, I can't stand it. I can't lie here anymore. You can't use general anesthesia because you've got to be sure you've got the electrode in the right place. And so they sent him to see me to prepare him for the surgery. And here's what happened.
Just lie down. Good.
So he was
going to
redo the whole thing.
So okay. How are you feeling now?
Pretty good.
Good.
A little tight in the ankles and
calves. A little tight in the ankles and calves?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I feel tight in that lower back.
He particularly had this movement in his right hand that he just couldn't control.
Anywhere else, or is that pretty much it?
And my neck. I'm just up and down the spine.
Mm-hmm.
Real tight.
Up and down your spine. Okay. Okay, good. All right, we're going to get some here. Okay. All right, good. Now, what I want you to do is to put yourself into the state of self-hypnosis that we've done together, and just take yourself to Hawaii, okay?
Now, notice the tremor just stopped, and I was not telling him to do that. I was just saying, go to Hawaii. It's a place he likes to go.
Deep breath. Breath out. Eyes relax. Let your body float. Just enjoy the floating and picture yourself on the beach in Hawaii planning your activities.
In the hour before, that hand hadn't stopped moving. And if you asked him to stop it, he'd say, I can't.
Feel the warmth of the sun penetrating into your body. And with each breath out, let a little more of the tension out so your muscles start to feel warm and loose. That's great. Each breath deeper and easier. Now, with your eyes closed and remaining in this state of concentration, please describe how you're feeling right now.
I'm a little wet. My feet are wet because of the sand.
A little wet, huh? The sand is wet. Okay, what else do you notice?
Kids are getting a little too far out.
Oh, you're getting nervous about the kids playing near the water, huh? Okay. And how's your body feeling?
Oh, warm.
Warm? Good. So you're feeling comfortable?
It's hot.
It's hot, so you feel that hot sun. Good.
Worried about getting sunburned.
Uh-huh. You know what, you're worried about getting a sunburn?
Worried about a sunburn.
All right, we better be careful.
Side effect is treatment, you know.
Okay. And so you're telling the kids to come closer?
Right.
Good. Are they listening to you?
No.
No? All right, you're good. They never do. All right. Good. Keep your body floating. How do your legs feel now?
Back's not sore anymore.
Good. Back's not sore anymore?
My quads are still tight.
Still tight?
And my ankle's still tight.
All right. Well, concentrate on the sun and the warmth in the back of your legs.
Okay, so here you had a guy who was having this restless tremor, and he could shift gears in a matter of seconds and go to some imaginary place, change the way it felt, and without any direct instruction could stop the tremor in his hand. Now, we got him through the surgical procedures. He still had them. It isn't a permanent treatment for Parkinson's. But it also shows how the overlay of arousal and anxiety can complicate many symptoms, many neurological symptoms. People with MS, for example, get around okay, but when they have to get on a bus, you know, when there's five people behind them, sometimes they have less physical control. So the interaction between the brain and even these very real serious brain diseases is something where we can intervene and help people manage some of these symptoms. So I'm going to skip now. I want to show you a few other examples of mind-body control. This was a study we did where we measured gastric acid secretion. We put down an NG tube. It was first thing in the morning because people had to be NPO. And in this case, we had them eat an imaginary meal. We took a culinary tour of the Bay Area. They were hypnotized. We found an 89% increase in gastric acid secretion, eating imaginary food. After 30 minutes, one subject said, "Let's stop, I'm full." She was just eating imaginary food. The next part of the experiment, we had people imagine anything except eating or drinking. So they were on a desert island. They were doing whatever they wanted to do. We had a 39% decrease in gastric acid secretion. So you could control gastric acid secretion in either direction, depending on what you were thinking about in hypnosis. And then Ken Klein, who did this with me, said, "I want to try something else." So we injected them with pentagastrin, which stimulates maximal parietal cell output, and had them in the relaxation condition. And we still had a significant 19% reduction in gastric acid. So the mind has incredible control that we don't credit ourselves for over functions like, for example, gastric acid secretion. Finally, we use it to help people stop smoking. I tell them three things. I don't say don't smoke. That's like telling people don't think about purple elephants. That's what you'll do. I say think about respecting and protecting your body. Think of your body as if it were a trusting, innocent child that has to take into it anything you put into it, even if it's damaged by it. So I tell them to repeat to themselves, "For my body, smoking is a poison. I need my body to live. I owe my body respect and protection." So do the same thing for your body in regard to smoking that you do in fastening a seatbelt or looking both ways when you cross the street. And what we find after teaching people this simple self-hypnosis exercise, one session, is that half the people we see will stop, and half of them will not touch a cigarette in 2 years. So we get 1 out of 4 long-term abstinence from smoking. I figure that's the best way I spend my time as a doctor. If I can get 1 out of 4 people to permanently stop smoking, it's a lot better than many of the other things I do. Finally, we had this guy who came to see me. He was a contractor down in south of Stanford. He'd had a very successful business. He was a bricklayer at the time, very successful, doing fine, and a defective ladder collapsed on his hand, gave him a compound fracture of his index finger. Before that, he'd been earning more than I was earning as an assistant professor at Stanford. And after that, he lost his job. His wife left him. He had to sell his home. And the insurance company said, "We're going to have to amputate your index finger. You'll never have a usable hand again." And they sent him to Bob Chase at Stanford, hand surgeon, great guy, said, "I'm not going to amputate this finger. Are you willing to try anything?" He said, "Yeah, even a psychiatrist." I said, "Well, maybe." He said, "Even one who uses hypnosis." He said, "Doc, I'm desperate." So he came to see me, and he'd been sent to a psychologist who said, "This is a fist. You're unconsciously angry at your employer." And he said, "Doc, I know I'm angry at my employer. This is not a secret, you know." And I found out they were secretly filming him to prove that he couldn't really, that he was actually using the hand, but they couldn't prove it. And I wouldn't believe it from the patient, but it was in his medical record, you know. So this poor guy's here 2.5 years after the injury, and his life is a wreck. And so I said, "You know, you got, I don't know why your hand's like this, and I don't care, you want to get better." And he said, "Yes." I said, "Well, we've got a rehabilitation plan here. You've got 4 centimeters less muscle mass in this forearm than the other. You've got horrible circulation in your hand, which we would all have if we just held our hand like this for a couple of years." So I said, "You're going to develop tremors in your hand." So he sat in my office in hypnosis, sweating with his hand shaking like this. And I had him practice twice a day for 30 minutes doing self-hypnosis. By the end of 3 months, he had full extension of all the fingers except the originally injured finger. And we gave him a tennis ball, an old tennis ball, to just strengthen his muscles. He actually ruptured some ligaments. We had to tell him to slow down. He was working too hard. Bob Chase put a dynamic splint on the originally injured finger. And by the end of a year, he had virtually full movement of the hand. He came into my clinic holding with a 35-pound brick that the secretary thought he was going to throw through the window or something. He put it there to show me he could use that hand to lay down the brick and he could start bricklaying again. I signed his union card, and he had to sue the union to get back to work. They didn't believe he actually could go back to work. And he could make a real fist when he wanted to. And he is now a contractor again in Monterey, once again earning more money than I am doing it. And when I presented him to the students, I would give my long description. He'd say, Doc, when do I get to show them what I did? So if you think that hypnosis is taking away control, it isn't. It's teaching people control. So we know that we can modulate perception. We can control pain and anxiety with hypnosis. And for those who are interested, we've written a book on how to use hypnosis called Trance and Treatment, Clinical Uses of Hypnosis, published by American Psychiatric Publishing. I want to acknowledge the National Center for Complementary and Integrative Health for their generous support of our work through a P30 as well as the ARA grant, National Institute on Aging, National Cancer Institute, National Institute of Mental Health, and these other programs as well. He's saying stress is killing you. You need an easier job, a smaller house, and a different family. We think there are other ways to help with stress. We opened our Center for Integrative Medicine at Stanford in 1998. We have a lovely facility now in the remodeled Hoover Pavilion. We have physicians, psychologists, acupuncturists, massage therapists, and several of us who use hypnosis, and we teach classes in mindfulness-based stress reduction and forgiveness. We treat a whole variety of clinical conditions, including the ones I've talked about. Pain, we treat chronic fatigue, smoking, anxiety-related disorders, and stress-related problems. Finally, the mind-body relationship is nothing to fool around with. He's saying, what happened here, Sergeant? He said it's a placebo overdose. We're pretty sure he only thinks he's dead. So with that, I thank you for your attention.